Hello and welcome to another of our Sunday morning services compiled from recordings of services that we've had here at St. Christopher's Potts Ridley over the past 18 months. It may feel a little bit strange to be worshipping God with recorded material rather than with a live stream service, but I firmly believe that our God is the God of the past, the present and the future, and that you can worship him in spirit and in truth by joining in wholeheartedly from wherever you're viewing this service, by joining in wholeheartedly in this worship yourself. There'll be our usual mix of hymns, prayers, readings and a talk, and various familiar faces will be presenting those different elements. As always, it's worth saying that they're from different periods. I think we have material from last January and even from July last year. And so you can well imagine that there's quite a variety of references, and in some cases, maybe some of the references in the prayers are a bit out of date. But even there, I think we can easily adapt our thoughts to make them a prayer for today. Well, in a moment, we're going to continue with an opening hymn. But first of all, I'd like to lead us in this prayer. Almighty God, God of yesterday, today and tomorrow, we thank you that you are present with us now, wherever we are, just as you were present with us when these recordings were made. Lord, we offer ourselves to you today in worship. We ask that we may lift our hearts to you in spirit and in truth, and that we may know your presence, and not only as we worship, but as we go forward into another week. We ask this in Jesus' name. Amen. Incidentally, for those who are attending church today, the 22nd of August, we'll be having the latest in our series, I Will Build My Church, and the subject today is You Called. And if you'd like to hear that sermon, it will be recorded and posted later on the same day on YouTube. I hope you'll have a look and see what you think. But now we have the first of our hymns, so let's worship God together.
To you, Wonderful to hear familiar voices praising God and leading us all in offering to Jesus the honor that his name deserves. Well, he also deserves us to be honest with him as we come before him. And if we're honest, we have things that we need to say to him, including that we're sorry for when we've let him down. And that's why we have our confession now, which enables us to do it together. The grace of God has dawned upon the world through our Saviour Jesus Christ, who sacrificed himself for us to purify a people as his own. Let us confess our sins. Almighty God, long-suffering and of great goodness, I confess with my whole heart my neglect and forgetfulness of your commandments, my wrongdoing, thinking and speaking, the hurts I have done to others, and the good I have left undone. O God, forgive me, for I have sinned against you, and raise me to newness of life through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. God, the Father of mercies, has reconciled the world to himself through the death and resurrection of his Son, Jesus Christ, not counting our trespasses against us, but sending his Holy Spirit to shed abroad his love among us. By the ministry of reconciliation entrusted by Christ to his church, receive his pardon and peace, to stand before him in his strength alone, this day and evermore. Amen.
From the letter to the Romans, chapter 8. Therefore, brothers and sisters, we have an obligation, but it is not to the flesh to live according to it. For if you live according to the flesh, you will die. But if by the Spirit you put to death the misdeeds of the body, you will live. For those who are led by the Spirit of God are the children of God. The Spirit you receive does not make you slaves, that you live in fear again. Rather, the Spirit you received brought about your adoption to sonship. And by him we cry, Abba, Father. The Spirit himself testifies with our spirit that we are God's children. Now if we are children, then we are heirs, heirs of God and co-heirs with Christ, if indeed we share in his sufferings, in order that we may also share in his glory. I consider that our present sufferings are not worth comparing to the glory that will be revealed in us. For the creation waits in eager expectation for the children of God to be revealed. For the creation was subjected to frustration, not by its own choice, but by the will of the one who subjected it, in the hope that the creation itself will be liberated from its bondage to decay and brought into the freedom and glory of the children of God. We know that the whole creation has been groaning as in the pains of childbirth right up until the present time. Not only so, but we ourselves, who have the first fruits of the Spirit, groan inwardly as we await eagerly the adoption to sonship, the redemption of our bodies. For in this hope we were saved. But hope that is seen is no hope at all. Who hopes for what they already have? But if we hope for what we do not yet have, we wait for it patiently. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
Thank you very much, Jenny. Last week, I spoke about freedom in Christ. If you recall, I referred especially to being set free from the burdens of expectation, requirements, and pressures which others may try to load onto us. And I ended my sermon with a phrase which appears in our reading today: the glorious liberty of the children of God. These words were written by St. Paul to Christians living in Rome. So imagine, if you will, a well-to-do Roman household back in those days. There's the master and mistress of the house, and there's the rest of the family, aged parents maybe, but also children, daughters, and the sons who will one day inherit their father's wealth and status. Now, there's also another group. the slaves. In law, this group are more objects, possessions of their owners, than people. They may be fortunate and be treated well, or they may be treated appallingly badly, but either way, they have no ability to make their own choices, no recourse to justice, no pay, no time to call their own, no rights, no freedom, and no hope that it will ever be any different. Slavery, whether in the ancient world, in more recent history, or in the present day, is a terrible, terrible condition. So when Paul says, "The Spirit you received does not make you slaves, rather, the Spirit you received brought about your adoption to sonship," when he says that, his words would paint the picture of a household slave being somehow promoted, indeed adopted, to being a child of the family, to being nothing less than a full heir of the Father, as Paul writes, "If we are children, then we are heirs, heirs of God and co-heirs with Christ." Now, of course, this scenario would be far-fetched, maybe even shocking, to Paul's Roman readers. And yet, says Paul, this is exactly what happens to us when we put our faith in Christ. We are adopted into the Father's family. No longer slaves, we are set free as sons and daughters of God. Our old masters, who kept us enslaved, have no power over us. Worry about tomorrow, bad habits and attitudes of mind, addictions, guilt and shame for the things we've done wrong, even death itself. In Christ, we are set free from slavery to all of these things. That is God's promise. It's his guarantee in Christ. Even if it sounds as implausible as that idea of a slave being adopted would have sounded to Paul's Roman readers. Now, one reason it might well sound implausible to you is because our day-to-day experience is that we are not yet free of those things. The bad habit or attitude we can never quite shake off. The worry which still plagues us. The temptations to which we still give in. But that's where the guarantee comes in. God's Holy Spirit is the guarantee. Paul says, "And by the Spirit we cry, Abba, Father." The Spirit himself testifies with our spirit that we are God's children. As far as God is concerned, our freedom is a reality now. And although we won't experience in all its fullness in this life, day by day we will discover it, grow into it, and by faith know it to be true. That's why Paul, who has just described our adoption as an established fact, can in the next breath speak of it as something which still lies ahead for us. He writes, "We who have the first fruits of the Spirit groan inwardly as we wait eagerly for our adoption to sonship." And then he writes, "Who hopes for what they already have? But if we hope for what we do not yet have, we wait for it patiently." It's a present reality, and yet it's something which is also to look forward to. Freedom, adoption. What amazing, breathtaking promise from God to you and to me. But there's something else in this passage which is equally breathtaking, equally startling, and it's this. Paul tells us that this promise of freedom is extended to the whole created order. We know, he writes, that the whole creation has been groaning as in the pains of childbirth right up to the present time. And then he speaks of the hope that creation itself will be liberated from its bondage to decay and brought into the glorious liberty of the children of God. Now, if your mind wasn't boggled before, it surely is now. I can hardly begin to get my own mind around what this means. And yet, I can see it makes sense. I can see that in us breaking our relationship with our Creator, we have brought about a dislocation in the whole created order. I can see that when we see a world which is so perfectly created, so astounding, beautiful, and intricate, and yet also so frightening and damaged, I can see that these words of Paul ring true. And I can see how wonderful it is that this hope of freedom is extended to God's creation. It's not just about me and my soul. Of course, I can also see that it means that I too should care about and care for God's creation too. This promise of freedom for me, for you, for our created world is the reality within which the Christian lives, guided, directed, driven, no longer by those old slave masters, but by God's Spirit. So let's give the last word to St. Paul. Therefore, brothers and sisters, we have an obligation, but it is not to the flesh to live according to it. For if you live according to the flesh, you will die. But if by the Spirit you put to death the misdeeds of the body, you will live. For those who are led by the Spirit of God are the children of God. Amen.
Thanks, David. It's time for us to affirm our faith together, which we're going to do using the following words based on Philippians chapter 2. Let us affirm our faith in Jesus Christ, the Son of God. Though he was divine, he did not cling to equality with God, but made himself nothing. Taking the form of a slave, he was born in human likeness. He humbled himself and was obedient to death, even the death of the cross. Therefore, God has raised him on high and given him the name above every name, that at the name of Jesus, every knee should bow and every voice proclaim that Jesus Christ is Lord, to the glory of God the Father. Amen. And we're going to turn to a time of prayer now. And our prayers today are led by Tom. So let's pray.
Heavenly Father, we thank you for the beauty of the world and especially the local countryside around us. We pray for all who live and work in our community and ask that as lockdown restrictions are gradually lifted, you look after us and keep us safe. We pray for your blessing on our church family here at St. Christopher's. Be with Vicar David and Kim, all those who share the good news of Jesus with us, and everyone working to help our church open for services again. Lord, we pray for your worldwide church, for wisdom and guidance for all church leaders, and we ask for your protection and support for our missionaries, the Fazakalis in Malawi and the Macleans in Thailand. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We bring to you our stewardship of the world's resources. Please be with all those making decisions regarding conservation, international relationships, and fighting diseases. And we ask that your generous will triumphs over human greed and prejudice. We pray for peace across the world. Bring an end to war and harmony to places where there is hatred between races and religions. Lord God, we pray for leaders across the world. Give them wisdom to know and courage to do what is right. May they all come together to try and find the path of truth, freedom, and peace, which is your will. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We bring to you in prayer those who we know are sick, lonely, anxious, or in some other special need. We think of the elderly, the housebound, and those in care homes, and we pray for all who minister to their needs. We lift to you those who mourn the loss of a loved one. Lord Jesus, who responded to the needs of those who had faith, comfort and sustain those who need your grace. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. And in closing, we pray for ourselves, our families and our friends. Help us to grow together in faith and love, and may we walk closely with you, aware that you are always with us. Merciful Father, accept these prayers for the sake of your Son, our Saviour, Jesus Christ. Amen.
Thanks, Tom. Now, as our Saviour Jesus taught us, let's pray together the Lord's Prayer. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen. And our collect for today. Almighty and everlasting God, by whose Spirit the whole body of the Church is governed and sanctified, hear our prayer which we offer for all your faithful people, that in their vocation and ministry they may serve you in holiness and truth, to the glory of your name, through our Lord and Saviour, Jesus Christ. Amen.
Make a gift. So we come to our final hymn, and this one is provided for us by the wider Church of England and by some lovely singers from elsewhere. We worship God as we come to the end of our service with Alleluia, Sing to Jesus.
Jesus, is the center.
Fantastic. And I do hope that you can hold a song of praise to God in your heart through this coming week, whatever lies ahead for you. And I do thank you too for joining me and joining one another. And I hope maybe you'll join in Zoom shortly so that you can have a bit of a chat and a catch up and keep in touch with each other. But we close with our blessing and dismissal. Christ, the Son of God, perfect in you the image of his glory and gladden your hearts with the good news of his kingdom. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be amongst you and remain with you always. Amen. Go in peace to love and serve the Lord. In the name of Christ. Amen.